Hey everyone, Armando here, and in this short video, I want to walk you through a template concerning the 7th edition APA. I want to be able to give you this template so that you can follow it for any future courses that you may take, any future assignments that you may need to write. And if you just follow the logistics and the basics of this very short video, then you will submit solid APA formatted papers. So let's start with the title page. As you can see right here, and I'm going to grab my tool. Okay, you've got the title of your essay, and then you're going to have a brief space, and then you're going to go into your first and last name. You're going to go into the university name. Now, if you're not from Grand Canyon University, that's fine. You would just substitute that with your university or college name. Then you will have your course code or the name of the course. So example, in this particular case, MGT 410 Servant Leadership. That would sit right in the middle here. Then you would have the instructor name, and then you would have the due date of the assignment. So this is the new 7th edition, okay, title page when it comes to APA. Now, let's give you some pointers as we scroll down. The next thing you need to be aware is the title of your essay. Now, let me make a note that in 7th edition, if you noticed, there is no running head up here. So the running head has been eliminated from the 7th edition, but we still have page numbers. Okay, so no running head, but we still have page numbers. So now let's go back to the title. We've got the title of our essay in bold, centered. And then, as you should have been learning since you were in high school, strong academic writing, you want to start with an introductory paragraph. Okay, so you can read here that the first paragraph here should introduce the reader to the subject. Okay, so you don't want to put introduction. You want to actually put the title of your essay, and then you want to welcome the reader or readers to what you are going to be talking about when it comes to your actual paper. Now, I've included this in here for you to review, and you can always pause this video and read it, but it's the writing process. Right, you should spend time planning your paper, right? Brainstorm your ideas, do a rough draft, and look at what main ideas or what's the main focus or the thesis of what you are writing about. Once you have that rough idea, you want to create that outline or that rough draft, and then you want to begin to build upon it. Just like a floor plan of a house, you want to have that floor plan, and then you want to begin with the foundation, and then you want to begin to construct the walls and eventually the roof of the house before turning it over. Same thing here. You want to construct your paper so that way you have a blueprint and you can kind of build upon it, take a look at whatever course rubrics that you may have, and decide, did I meet the expectation of the assignment? And did I fall short? Did I overwrite? And then you can begin to go from there. Now, in this third section, we're going to talk about writing the body of the paragraph. So we know that good writing, introduction, body, and then eventually we get to that conclusion, right? So we want to make sure that our sentences are clear and they're easy to follow. Okay, as mentioned in the Writing Center and in most universities the same, you're going to need in-text citations. So in-text citations must be used when providing information from a source into your paper. So unless your assignment is a 100% opinion-based paper, which in my courses, they're not, you are going to be using in-text citations to make the connection from where did you learn that from? Where did that idea come from? Where did that article take you? What did you learn about that piece of research? And you are not only going to have a reference page, but you need to document that progress of where you're actually writing at the time. Let's say it was this paragraph, that you are actually including that in-text citations. So there are two ways that you can cite, parenthetical and narrative. And I go ahead and explain it here, that the parenthetical citation saves all the information for the end of the sentence. So that would be where at the end of the sentence, before closing the sentence with punctuation, this would be an example. You would include the author, comma, year, comma, and then what page number did that information come from? Now, in the narrative citation, for example, you may only start with the author and the year up here somewhere. And then as you continue to make reference to that journal or to that author, and you continue writing, then at the end, you're just gonna save in brackets the page numbers or page number where you obtain the information from, and then you'll close it with a punctuation. So either way, depending on what you're looking to do in that paragraph, for example, you have two choices. You can do it this style, as you go every couple of lines or what have you, or at the end, or you can break it up with author and year. And then at the end of that section where you mainly talked about that particular author, you can just close it up with the page numbers that were included. So that goes the same for every section of the body paragraphs. Now, as we move further along, there will probably be level two headings and beyond. So what the headings do, what these level two headings do, is that they break up your paper. So if you are talking about four different types of values, each section for each value should be separated into your paper. It should just not be four different paragraphs, but never letting the reader know that you switched from one value to another. If you're talking about the three steps of something, every step should have its own section. And so what you do is you highlight every step or every section with a level two. And the easiest way to do this, and this is the most common ones, is just to go ahead and bold it, flush left, and title case, just like this. That is a very common level two heading that is used, I would say, in over 90% of papers, and more than justified. Now, there are other types of headers that you can use, and there's some for longer papers, but for the most part, in my course and in most academic courses in the undergraduate and basic graduate level, you're going to be okay with this type of level two heading, which can be placed to classify and organize your paper into the different sections. Okay. Now, as we move down, this is an example of a level three. And again, here as a level three, the difference here is that you can see here, this is italicized. Okay. So it's still bold. It's still to the left, but we're going to italicize it. And this is to show the readers where the paragraph begins using a level three. So for example, if you were talking about a particular value and you wanted to break that value into a sub value, then a level three heading would be used to talk about the sub value within the main value. So if I was talking about loyalty as, for example, a trait in leadership, and that was my main value, but then I wanted to talk about loyalty to employees and then loyalty to the stakeholders, those are going to be different sections under loyalty. I would use a level three heading to break up the loyalty to the employees and the loyalty to the stakeholders, but everything falls under the level two, which was the main section, what we started talking about, loyalty. Okay. And again, if you have any questions, I encourage you to go down to the comments section of this video, ask them, and I will get back to you within 24 to 48 hours and even provide samples if needed. Now, as we wrap up the assignment, obviously you're gonna have a conclusion, but I'm gonna talk here now about using citations correctly. So again, your papers should include in-text citations, and I made some of these in blue so that can stand out. Information that is summarized, paraphrase, or quoted needs to be directly cited, meaning you need to give credit to where you found that information. We didn't come up with that information, but yet we used that information. And again, here we explain one more time about the two different types of citations, which we covered a little bit earlier in the video. Now, in some assignments, you're going to be required to use tables, graphs, and images and appendices. So right here, right, you would include that at the end of your paper, okay? So don't put it inside of the beginning or the middle. You want to include any tables, graphs, images, what have you, at the end of your assignment. And again, I would encourage you that if your professor has a specific way to submit it, then obviously you will defer to that particular way. But for APA 7th edition, okay, you want to place this at the end of your paper. And these things help do what? Create a visual representation of the data to help your reader understand what you are talking about. And then as we scroll down in 7th edition APA, we have a reference page. Nothing has changed. This still goes bolded black in the middle. We still have our left-hand margin in alphabetical order based on the author. What has changed now is that you can just input the link that may be associated to where you found that information here. So you would have, for example, the author, the year, the title of this periodical, the volume number, the page number, and then where did you obtain that from? That could be, for example, from the Grand Canyon University Library. That can be from an exterior web source. Whatever case that may be, you will include that here in the seventh edition, which is a change from previous versions. Okay. And then lastly is you want to make sure that your sources and your in-text citations match your reference page. So if I'm placing something here in my reference page, I should be able to find that same reference somewhere along my content along the way. So these should match, because if you're citing something as a reference, you're telling the reader, I went to this journal, I used this information. And so if you talked about that information at all in your paper, because you're using it as a reference, then that in-text citation should be matching somewhere up here with regard to the reference page. So I hope this short video kind of explained or helped out and look at some of the differences between maybe sixth edition or seventh edition, or if you're kind of new to doing APA, this is the latest edition. And if you can just follow this very simple format, right? The content is yours. That's something that you're going to create. But if you just follow this simple format, if you rewatch this video a couple times, if you pause it and you look how the sections are broken down and what's included, then you will be fine. And the last note I want to bring up is that in this section where we had this title of our essay, you would do the exact same thing for a conclusion. So the conclusion, for example, instead of having title of your essay, you would have conclusion somewhere down here centered. Let's use this as our conclusion example. So the word conclusion would go here, and then you would use a brief paragraph to basically bring it home, capsulize everything you talked about in your paper, and that would go just before your reference page. Okay, if you have any questions, drop them down in the comments. If you got some value in this video, whether a refresher or some brand new information, hit that like button. Again, if you're brand new to my channel, hit the subscribe button. And whether you're connected with my university or not, I'll continue to do helpful educational videos to help you in your academic journey. Thank you for watching and have a blessed day.